As you know, our profession of being a good advocate is more about being a good listener and even more a good thinker. If I may borrow the words of Bruce Lee, the famous Kung Fu fighter, who described Kung Fu as the art of fighting without fighting. And if I were to apply it to our profession, advocacy is the art of arguing without arguing. So what is advocacy? Or what is the art of advocacy? For this, I would first like to read to you two passages which I found very interesting from a book written about one of the most eminent QCs, Jeremy Hutchinson. The book is called Jeremy Hutchinson's Case Histories by a gentleman called Mr. Thomas Grant, who is the author of the book. Jeremy practiced criminal law and was considered the leader of the criminal bar in London in the 60s, 70s and 80s, and later became a member of the House of Lords. What does he have to say about the art of advocacy? Let me read to you a passage, and it so aptly describes what we are here today to talk about. Advocacy, I think every word is important. Advocacy is the art of persuasive and attractive speech. Nowadays, the student must attend many hours of advocacy training. Indeed, the main remaining role of the Inns of Court now appears to be just that, the upholding of integrity, duty to the court, the overwhelming importance of preparation, mastering the law and the facts can all be taught. But as Lord Burkitt once pointed out, how can one teach that skill that could win from the diarist John Aubrey when speaking of Lord Chancellor Bacon, the comment, it was the fear of all who heard him that he would make an end, or from Pitt the Younger, when replying to an expression of surprise at the huge reputation of Charles James Fox, when he said, "Ah, but you have never been under the word of the magician. There lies the art of advocacy," unquote. There is one more passage in the same book which is shorter and again very pithily summarizes what I want to talk to you about, and that says, like conversation or theatre, the essence of advocacy is the impression it makes at the moment it is given voice. To the immediate audience to whom it is made, the words themselves and the meanings they are intended to convey are only half of the effect. Put fine words into the mouth of a poor advocate, and those words can die on the tongue. Whereas a great advocate can conjure magic out of the proverbial laundry list, unquote. So this gives you a flavor of what art of advocacy is about. You can conjure magic out of a laundry list. I would also like to read to you another short passage from Fali Nariman's latest book called God Save the Honorable Supreme Court on advocacy and constitutional law. And the reason why I wanted to draw attention to this passage is because it tells us how advocacy is what is behind the development of our constitutional law. Let me read to you a short passage from this book which is written about Mr. Palkhiwala. And this is what it says, and I'm quoting, "It brings out India's constitutional history in the making. And it was in this struggle for the custody of the constitution between parliament and the court that the true art of superlative advocacy was witnessed. The struggle ultimately resulted in the establishment of the supremacy neither of parliament nor of the court, but of the constitution itself. This was accomplished through an innovative doctrine now known as the basic structure of the constitution." So this gives you a flavor how advocacy can play a huge role in the development of the law itself, whether it be constitutional law or any other form of law which you practice. As juniors who are fortunate to be part of my chambers, and some of them are here today, would tell you, what you see in court is only 1/10 of what really goes on in an advocate's life. As Biren mentioned, advocacy in court is virtually the last mile. It's really the 9/10 of the effort that goes in the chambers, where you sit and you dissect and you bisect and you trisect and you look at every single angle. You call for the law, you look at the facts, you anticipate what the other side may argue, you anticipate what the judge may ask, you rule out what you think will not sell, you accept from the team that you may be leading some good argument, some good thought, some facts, and you put it all together. That is really where the real work is done. For an outsider, for a stranger, for a person who's visiting, for a person who may happen to be in court, when he hears an attractive argument, he may even go back thinking, so what was so great? But obviously that's because that person doesn't know that to make that last mile argument, there is so much that has gone behind it. There is so much of picking and there is so much of discarding that takes place, which an outsider would never ever see or never know. That is also part of the art of advocacy. Now, there is always a difference between lawyering and advocacy. Lawyering is nothing but applying a set of facts, taking a set of facts and applying the law to it, whether it be a particular document or it be a pleading. Advocacy is something which takes those facts and the law to a different level altogether. It begins where lawyering ends. So really speaking, it's the next level. And that is where your ingenuity comes in as an advocate. I often give the example to people that in a case, don't forget the fact that the same brief which you have read has been read by the entirety of the other side, because there are no surprises here. The same law which you may have studied and you may have researched is going to be researched by the other side. The same brief would have been read by your team, your clients, your juniors, your solicitors and what have you. And yet, it is going to be that one person who is going to make the difference to winning and losing. And that is because advocacy is not written into the brief. Advocacy is what is outside the brief. And that is where your ingenuity, your thinking, your application of mind as an advocate will come into play. And unless you can play on the psychology of the judge, because ultimately, don't forget, he's a human being. He's not a computer. It's not that you put in the facts and out comes the result. He will have his own set of leanings, prejudices, biases, and I don't mean it in a bad way, but you know, everybody, we all have our own failings, we all are, you know, lean in favor of one or the other, or we get prejudiced in some form or the other, depending on the subject, depending on the matter, depending on the facts, depending on what is told to us. So playing on the psychology of the judge becomes a very important aspect, and which you must ultimately know is crucial to our profession. In the hotel industry, if you ask somebody what are the three things which make a great hotel, and they will tell you location, location, location. If you ask me what are the three words that describe our profession, I would say anticipation, anticipation, anticipation.